Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Wonders of the Invisible World by Patricia A. McKillip, narrated by Tim Campbell and Amy Landon. Introduction, Charles de Lint. If you want to know who Patricia McKillip is, just read her stories. Really, all we need to know about the creative individuals who fill our lives with their poetry, prose, music, and art is waiting for us right there in the work itself. But we're always curious, aren't we? When something moves us, we want, almost need, to know more about the individual who was able to wake such a reaction in us. It can be a double-edged sword, of course. Sometimes the person is everything we hoped they would be, with a heart beating in their chest as big and generous as we imagined. Their eyes are so clear and wise that it seems utterly appropriate that they give us a more profound experience of the world's mysteries. Other times, the person is so wrong in terms of how we imagine them that we can no longer engage in their art in the same way that once we did. It's a curious thing, but even when we know that it might turn out badly, we still walk into the riddle that is the artist whose work we admire so much, hoping for the best. The truth is, more often than not, despite their spark of genius, these artists are not unlike you or me, a mix of good and bad, patient and intolerant, welcoming and private, all in varying degrees. And of course, we are all different, depending on the day and situation in which we find ourselves. So I can't tell you who the real Patricia McKillip is. All I can tell you is who she is to me. Like most of you, I first met her in the pages of one of her books. For me, it was The Forgotten Beasts of Eld. I remember it was the Avon paperback edition that came out in the mid-70s, which means I've been reading her for around 35 years. I adored that book. Then The Riddlemaster of Head came out a year or so later, and I became completely smitten. When I went looking for more by her, I was surprised to discover that her novels came out first in hardcover as young adult books, then were reprinted as adult paperbacks. I tracked them all down, and to this day, I always pick up her new books. If you're reading this, you know why. They're just so damned good. She's one of the few writers I've read who hasn't written a bad book. I don't think she has it in her. For all that I love the secondary world novels for which she is best known, my favorite book of hers is probably Stepping from the Shadows, a standalone contemporary book that contains the idea of fantasy more than the actual trappings. Note to self, it's time to reread that book. The first time I actually met Pat was at one of the New England World Fantasy Conventions, where I asked her to sign my advance reading copy of that selfsame Stepping from the Shadows. I remember her being soft-spoken and charming, and a little aghast that I'd bought an expensive ARC in the dealer's room when I already owned a copy of the book. But I didn't have the hardcover with me, and I really wanted a personalized book to bring home and treasure. And ever since, I continue to see her at World Fantasy Conventions whenever we both happen to attend. Through the years, these cons have become the only place where I can spend time with people I don't normally get to see. Writers, artists, editors, and readers from different parts of the continent and the world gather in a hotel in some major city to, well, mostly sit around in the hotel bar and schmooze with each other. One particular afternoon in one of these hotel bars remains a fond memory for me, sitting around a large round table with Pat, Terry Windling, and Midori Schneider, as we went through a big stack of Brian Froud's art, choosing the pieces that would appear in the books we would write for a series called Brian Froud's Fairylands. Sadly, only two of the books came out in their planned illustrated form, my The Wild Wood and Pat's lovely Something Rich and Strange. I'm not sure why the series was canceled. Terry's The Woodwife and Midori's Hannah's Garden were published. How could two such fine books not be published? But it would have been so much nicer to have the illustrated quartet all be available, as originally intended, resplendent with Brian's art. In another world, I'm sure that happened. We're simply not privy to it. What I remember most of that afternoon as we were choosing the art was how there were no arguments, gentle or otherwise. We each just kept picking the illustrations we wanted and there was no overlap. We were delighted in each other's choices, but were completely satisfied with what we got for our own books. And that's how I know Pat outside of her stories. Every time I've seen her at a world fantasy convention, she remains soft-spoken and charming, gracious and articulate, and a little shy, too. Or is that me, still smitten with one of my literary heroes after all these years? If you need to know more, turn to the reprint of her 2004 WizCon Guest of Honor speech at the end of this collection, which will give you a taste of her life outside of her books. Though really, as I said earlier, you're best off to dive right into the stories collected here. They might surprise you, because she doesn't always write the gentle fantasies with which she is usually associated. Her contemporary settings, which can have a little bit of a darker edge, are a perfect contrast to her gentler fantasies. She does both so very well. Charles de Lint, Ottawa, Canada, Spring 2012. Wonders of the Invisible World. I am the angel sent to Cotton Mather. It took me some time to get his attention. He lay on the floor with his eyes closed. He prayed fervently, sometimes murmuring, sometimes shouting. Apparently the household was used to it. I heard footsteps pass his study door. A woman, his wife, Abigail, called to someone. If your throat is no better tomorrow, we'll have Philip pee in a cup for you to gargle. From the way the house smelled, Philip didn't bother much with cups. Cotton Mather smelled of smoke and sweat and wet wool. Winter had come early. The sky was black, the ground was white, the wind pinched like a witch and whined like a starving dog. There was no color in the landscape, and no mercy. Cotton Mather prayed to see the invisible world. He wanted an angel. Oh, Lord, he said in desperate, hoarse, weary cadences, like a sick child talking itself to sleep. Thou hast given angelic visions to thy innocent children to defend them from their demons. Remember thy humble servant who prostrates himself in the dust, vile worm that I am, forsaking food and comfort and sleep, in humble hope that thou might bestow upon thy humble servant the blessing and hope at this harsh and evil time. A glimpse of thy shadow, a flicker of light in thine eye, a single word from thy mouth. Show me thy messengers of good who fly between the visible and invisible worlds. Grant me, O God, a vision. I cleared my throat a little. He didn't open his eyes. The fire was dying down. I wondered who replenished it, and if the sight of Mather's bright, winged creature would surprise anyone, with all the witches, devils, and demented goldfinches perched on rafters all over New England. The firelight spilling across the wide planks glowed just beyond his outstretched hand. He lay in dim lights and fluttering shadows, in the long, long night of history, when no one could ever see clearly after sunset, and witches and angels and living dreams trembled just beyond the fire. Grant me, O God, a vision. I was standing in front of his nose. He was lost in days of fasting and desire, trying to conjure an angel out of his head. According to his writings, what he expected to see was the generic white male with wings growing out of his shoulders, fair-haired, permanently beardless, wearing a long white nightgown and a gold dinner plate on his head. This was what intrigued Durham, and why he had hired me. He couldn't believe that both good and evil in the Puritan imagination could be so banal. But I was what Mather wanted, something as colorless and pure as the snow that lay like the hand of God over the earth, harsh, exacting, unambiguous. Fire, their salvation against the cold, was red and belonged to hell.
Oh, Lord.
It was the faintest of whispers. He was staring at my feet. They were bare and shining, getting chilled. The ring of diamonds in my halo contained controls for light, for holograms like my wings, a map disc, a local history disc in case I got totally bewildered by events, and a recorder disc that had caught the sudden stammer in Mather's last word. He had asked for an angel. He got an angel. I wished he would quit staring at my feet and throw another log on the fire. He straightened slowly, pushing himself off the floor while his eyes traveled upward. He was scarcely 30 at the time of the trials. He resembled his father at that age more than the familiar Pelham portrait of Mather in his 60s, soberly dressed, with a wig like a cream puff on his head and a firm, resigned mouth. The young Mather had long, dark hair, a spare, handsome, clean-shaven face, searching, credulous eyes. His eyes reached my face, finally, cringing a little, as if he half expected a demon's red, leering face attached to the angel's body. But he found what he expected. He began to cry. He cried silently, so I could speak. His writings are mute about much of the angel's conversation. Mostly it predicted Mather's success as a writer, great reviews, and spectacular sales in America and Europe. I greeted him, gave him the message from God, quoted Ezekiel, and then got down to business. By then he had stopped crying, wiped his face with his dusty sleeve, and cheered up at the prospect of fame. "There are troubled children," I said, "who have seen me."
"They speak of you in their misery," he said gratefully. "You give them strength against evil."
"Their afflictions are terrible."
"Yes,"
he whispered. "You have observed their torments."
"Yes."
"You have taken them into your home, borne witness to their complaints, tried to help them cast out their tormentors."
"I have tried."
"You have wrestled with the invisible world."
"Yes."
We weren't getting very far. He still knelt on the hard floor as he had done for hours, perhaps days. He could see me more clearly than he had seen anything in the dark in his life. He had forgotten the fire. I had tried to be patient. Good angels were beyond temperament, even while at war with angels who had disgraced themselves by exhibiting human characteristics. But the floorboards were getting very cold. "You have felt the invisible chains about them," I prodded. "The invisible hellish things moving beneath their bedclothes."
"The children cannot seem to stand my books," he said a little querulously, with a worried frown. "My writing sends them into convulsions. At the mere act of opening my books, they fall down as dead upon the floor. Yet how can I lead them gently back to God's truth if the truth acts with such violence against them?"
"It is not against them," I reminded him, "but against the devil, who," I added, inspired, "takes many shapes." He nodded and became voluble.
"Last week he took the shape of thieves who stole 3 sermons from me, and of a rat, or something like a hellish rat, we could feel in the air but not see."
"A rat?"
"And sometimes a bird, a yellow bird, the children say. They see it perched on the fingers of those they name witches."
"And since they say it, it is so." He nodded gravely.
"God made nothing more innocent than children."
I let that pass. I was his delusion, and if I had truly been sent to him from God, then God and Mather agreed on everything. "Have they," this was Durham's suggestion, "not yet seen the devil in the shape of a black horse who spews fire between its teeth and is ridden by 3 witches, each more beautiful than the last?" He stared at me, then caught himself imagining the witches and blinked.
"No," he breathed, "no one has seen such a thing. Though the shape of Goody Bishop in her scarlet bodice and her lace had been seen over the beds of honest married men."
"What did she do to them?"
"She hovered, she haunted them. For this and more, she was hanged."
For wearing a collar and inciting the imagination, she was hanged. I refrained from commenting that since her shape had done the hovering, it was her shape that should have been hanged. But it was almost worth my researcher's license. "In God's justice," I said piously, "her soul dwells." I'd almost forgotten the fire. This dreary, crazed, malicious atmosphere was more chilling than the cold.
"She had a witch mark," Mather added. "The witch's teat."
His eyes were wide, marveling. He had conjured witches as well as angels out of his imagination. I suppose it was easier in that harsh world to make demons out of your neighbors, with their imperfections, tempers, rheumy eyes, missing teeth, irritating habits and smells, than to find angelic beauty in them. But I wasn't there to judge Mather. I could hear Durham's intense voice.
"Imagination, imagery. I want to know what they pulled out of their heads. They invented their devil, but all they could do was make him talk like a bird. Don't bother with a moral viewpoint. I want to know what Mather saw." This was the man who believed that thunder was caused by the sulfurous farts of decaying vegetation. "Why? Don't ask me why. You're a researcher. Go research."
Research the imagination. It was as obsolete as the appendix in most adults, except for those in whom, like the appendix, it became inflamed for no reason. Durham's curiosity seemed as aberrated as Mather's. They both craved visions, but in his world, Durham could afford the luxury of being crazed. In this world, only the crazed, the adolescent girls, the trial judges, Mather himself, were sane. I was taking a moral viewpoint. But Mather was still talking, and the recorder was catching his views, not mine. I had asked Durham once, after an exasperating journey to some crowded, airless, fly-infested temple covered with phallic symbols to appear as a goddess, to stop hiring me.
The central research computer had obviously got its records mixed when it recommended me to him. Our historical viewpoints were thoroughly incompatible. No, they're not, he had said obnoxiously and refused to elaborate. He paid well. He paid very well. So here I was, in frozen colonial New England, listening to Cotton Mather talk about brooms.
The witches ride them, he said, still wide-eyed, sometimes three to a besom, to their foul witches' sabbaths.
Their foul sabbaths, he elaborated, consisted of witches gathering in some boggy pasture where the demons talked with the voices of frogs, listening to a fiendish sermon, drinking blood, and plotting to bring back pagan customs like dancing around a maypole. I wondered if, being an angel of God, I was supposed to know all this already, and if Mather would wonder later why I had listened. Durham and I had argued about this, about the ethics and legalities of me pretending to be Mather's delusion. What's the problem? He had asked. You think the real angel is going to show up later? Mather was still speaking, in a feverish trance caused most likely by too much fasting, prayer, and mental agitation. Evil eyes he was talking about, and things that were hairy all over. They apparently caused neighbors to blame one another for dead pigs, wagons stuck in potholes, sickness, lust, and deadly boredom. I was getting bored myself by then, and thoroughly depressed. Children's fingers had pointed at random, and wherever they pointed, they created a witch. So much for the imagination. It was malignant here, an instrument of cruelty and death.
He did not speak to the court, neither to defend his innocence nor confess his guilt, Mather was saying solemnly. He was a stubborn old man. They piled stones upon him until his tongue stuck out and he died. But he never spoke. They had already hanged his wife. He spoke well enough then, accusing her.
I had heard enough. God protect the innocent, I said, and surprised myself, for it was a prayer to something. I added, more gently, for Mather, blinking out of his trance, looked worried, as if I had accused him. Be comforted. God will give you strength to bear all tribulations in these dark times. Be patient and faithful, and in the fullness of time you will be rewarded with the truth of your life. Not standard Puritan dogma, but all he heard was reward and truth. I raised my hand in blessing. He flung himself down to kiss the floor at my feet. I activated the controls in my halo and went home. Durham was waiting for me at the researcher's terminus. I pulled the recorder disc out of my halo, fed it to the computer, and then stepped out of the warp chamber. While the computer analyzed my recording to see if I'd broken any of 1,563 regulations, I took off my robe and my blonde hair and dumped them in my halo into Durham's arms. Well, he said, not impatient, just intent, not even seeing me as I pulled a skirt and tunic over my head. I was still cold and worried about my researcher's license, which the computer would refuse to return if I had violated history. Durham had eyes like Cotton Mather's, I saw for the first time, dark, burning, but with a suggestion of humor in them. What did you find? Speak to me, Nikki. Nothing, I said shortly. You're out several million credits for nothing. It was a completely dreary bit of history, not without heroism, but entirely without poetry. And if I've lost my license because of this, I'm not even sure I understand what you're trying to do. I'm researching for a history of imaginative thought. Durham was always researching unreadable subjects. Starting when? I asked tersely, pulling on a boot. The cave paintings at Lascaux? No art, he said. More speculative than that. Less formal. Closer to chaos. He smiled, reading my mind. Like me. You're a disturbed man, Durham. You should have your unconscious scanned. I like it the way it is, a bubbling little morass of unpredictable metaphors. They aren't unpredictable, I said. They're completely predictable. Everything imaginable is accessible, and everything accessible has been imagined by the virtual computer, which has already researched every kind of imaginative thought since the first bison got painted on a rock. That way nothing like what happened in Cotton Mather's time can happen to us. So, wonders of the invisible world, Durham interrupted. He hadn't heard a word. It's a book by Mather. He was talking about angels and demons. We would think of the invisible in terms of atomic particles. Both are unseen yet named and immensely powerful. Oh, stop. You're mixing atoms and angels. One exists, the other doesn't. That's what I'm trying to get at, Nikki. The point where existence is totally immaterial, where the passion, the belief in something, creates a situation completely ruled by the will to believe.
That's insanity. He smiled again cheerfully.
He tended to change his appearance according to what he was researching. He wore a shimmering bodysuit that showed all his muscles and milk-white hair. Except for the bulky build of his face and the irreverence in his eyes, he might have been Mather's angel. My more androgynous face worked better.
Maybe, he said, but I find the desire, the passion, coupled with the accompanying imagery, fascinating.
You are a throwback, I muttered. You belong to some barbaric age when people imagined things to kill each other for.
The computer flashed a light. I breathed a sigh of relief. Durham got his tape and the computer's analysis. I retrieved my license.
Next time, Durham began. There won't be a next time. I headed for the door. I'm sick of appearing as twisted pieces of people's imagination. And one of these days, I'm going to find myself in court.
But you do it so well, he said softly. You even convinced the Terminus computer.
I glared at him. Just leave me alone.
All right, he said imperturbably. Don't call me. I'll call you.
I was tired, but I took the tube walk home to get the blood moving in my feet and to see some light and color after that bleak, dangerous world. The moving walkway, encased in its clear tube, wound up into the air, balanced on its centipede escalator and station legs. I could see the gleaming city dome stretch like a long cluster of soap bubbles toward the afternoon sun, and I wondered that somewhere within the layers of time in this place, there was a small port town on the edge of a vast, unexplored continent where Mather had flung himself down on his floorboards and prayed an angel out of himself. He could see an angel here without praying for it. He could be an angel. He could soar into the eye of God if he wanted, on wings of gold and light. He could reach out even in the tube walk, punch in a credit number, plug into his implant or his wrist controls, and activate the screen above his head. He could have any reality on the menu, or any reality he could dream up, since everything imagined and imaginable, and every combination of it had been programmed into the virtual computer. And then he could walk out of the station into his living room and change the world all over again. I had to unplug Brock when I got home. He had fallen asleep at the terminal. He opened heavy eyelids and yawned.
Hi, Matrix.
Don't call me that, I said mechanically. He grinned fleetingly and nestled deeper into the bubble chair. I sat down on the couch and pulled my boots off again. It was warm in this time. I finally felt it. Brock asked,
What were you?
Even he knew Durham that well. An angel.
What's that?
Look it up. He touched the controls on his wrist absently. He was a calm child, with blue, clinical eyes and angelic hair that didn't come from me. He sprouted wings and a halo suddenly and grunted,
What's it for?
It talks to God.
What God?
In God we trust, that God. He grunted again,
Pre-real.
I nodded, leaned back tiredly and watched him, wondering how much longer he would be neat, attentive, curious, polite, before he shaved his head, studded his scalp and eyebrows with jewels and implants, got eye implants that held no expression whatsoever, inserted a CD player into his earlobe and never called me Matrix again. Maybe he would go live with his father. I hadn't seen him since Brock was born, but Brock knew exactly who he was, where he was, what he did. Speculation was unnecessary, except for aberrants like Durham. The outer comm signaled. Half a dozen faces appeared on screen. Brock's friends who lived in the station complex. They trooped in, settled themselves around Brock, and plugged into their wrists. They were playing an adventure game, a sort of space chase, where they were intergalactic thieves raiding alien zoos of rare animals and selling them to illegal restaurants. The computer played the team of highly trained intergalactic space patrollers. The thieves were constantly falling into black holes, getting burnt up, speeding too fast into strange atmospheres, and ambushed by the wily patrollers. One of them, Indra, tried to outwit the computer by coming up with the most bizarre alien species she could imagine. The computer always gave her the images she wanted. I watched for a while. Then an image came into my head of an old man in a field watching his neighbors pile stones on him until he could no longer breathe. I got up, went into my office, and called Durham. I could have stopped it, I said tersely. He was silent. Not because he didn't know what I was talking about, but because he did. I was an angel from God. I could have changed the message. You wouldn't have come back, he said simply. It was true. I would have been abandoned there, powerless, a beardless youth with breasts, in a long robe raving about the future, who would have become just one more witch for the children to condemn. He added, "You're a researcher. Researchers don't get emotional about history. There's nothing left of that time but some old bones in a museum from where they dug them up to build a station complex. A gravestone with an angel on it, a little face with staring eyes, and a pair of cupid wings. What's to mope about? I put a bonus in your account. Go spend it somewhere." "How much?" He was silent again, his eyes narrowed slightly. "Not enough for you to go back. Go get drunk, Nikki. This is not you."
"I'm haunted," I whispered.
I thought too softly for him to hear. He shook his head, not impatiently. "The worst was over by then anyway. Heroics are forbidden to researchers, you know that. The angel Mather dreamed up only told him what he wanted to hear. Tell him anything else and he'd call you a demon and refuse to listen. You know all this. Why are you taking this personally? You didn't take being a goddess in that Hindu temple personally, thank God," he added with an obnoxious chuckle. I grunted at him morosely and got rid of his face. I found a vegetable bar in the kitchen and wandered back into the living room. The space thieves were sneaking around a zoo on their planet Hooplat. They were all imaging animals on screen while their characters studied the specimens.
"We're looking for a usalope," Brock said intently. "Its eyeballs are poisonous, but if you cook them just right, they look like boiled eggs to whoever you're trying to poison."
The animals were garish in their barred cells, purple, orange, cinnamon, polka-dotted, striped. There were walking narwhals, a rhinoceros horn with feet and eyes, something like an octopus made out of elephant trunks, an amorphous green blob that constantly changed shape. "How'll you know a usalope when you see it?" I asked, fascinated with their color combinations, their imagery. Brock shrugged slightly.
"We'll know."
A new animal appeared in an empty cage, a tall, two-legged creature with long golden hair and wings made of feathers or light. It held onto the bars with its hands, looking sadly out. I blinked. "You have an angel in your zoo." I heard Brock's breath. Indra frowned.
"It could fly out. Why doesn't it fly? Whose is it? Anyway, this zoo is only for animals. This looks like some species of human. It's illegal," she said,
fastidiously for a thief.
"On Hooplat."
"It's an angel," Brock said.
"What's an angel? Is it yours?"
Brock shook his head. They all shook their heads, eyes on screen, wanting to move on. But the image lingered, a beautiful, melancholy figure, half human, half light, trapped and powerless behind its bars.
"Why doesn't it just fly?" Intra breathed. "It could just fly. Brock, it's not mine,"
Brock insisted. And then he looked at me, his eyes wide, so calm and blue that it took me a moment to transfer my attention from their color to what they were asking. I stared at the angel and felt the bars under my hands. I swallowed, seeing what it saw, the long, dark night of history that it was powerless to change, to illumine. Because it was powerless to speak, except to lie.
"Matrix?" Brock whispered.
I closed my eyes. "Don't call me that." When I opened my eyes, the angel had disappeared.
Out of the Woods. The scholar came to live in the old cottage in the woods one spring. Lita didn't know he was there until Dylan told her of the man's request. Dylan, who worked with wood, cut and sold it, mended it, built with it, whittled it into toothpicks when he had nothing better to do, found the scholar under a bush, digging up henbane, from which Dylan concluded the young man was possibly dotty, possibly magical, but, from the look of him, basically harmless.
"He wants a housekeeper," he told Lita. "Someone to look after him during the day. Cook, wash, sew, dust, straighten, buy his food, talk to peddlers, that sort of thing. You go there in the mornings, come back after his supper."
Lita rolled her eyes at her brawny, comely husband over the washtub as she pummeled dirt out of his shirts. She was a tall, wiry young woman with her yellow hair in a braid. Not as pretty or as bright as some, but strong and steady as a good horse, was how her mother had put it when Dylan came courting her.
"They used to do it around here?"
she asked mildly, being of placid disposition. Dylan shrugged, wood chips from a stick of kindling curling under his knife edge, for he had no more pressing work.
"It'll get done," he said.
He sent a couple more feathery chips floating to his feet. Then added,
earn a little money for us. Buy some finery for yourself. Ribbon for your cap. Shoe buckle.
She glanced down at her scuffed, work-worn clogs. Shoes, she thought, with sudden longing. And so the next day she went to the river's edge and then took the path downriver to the scholar's cottage. She'd known the ancient woman who had died there the year before. The cottage needed care. Flowers and moss sprouted from its thatch. The old garden was a tangle of vegetables, herbs, and weeds. The cottage stood in a little clearing surrounded by great oak and ash, near the river, and not far from the road that ran from one end of the wood to the other. The scholar met her at the door, as though he expected her. He was a slight, bony young man, with pale thinning hair and gray eyes that seemed to look at her, through her, and beyond her, all at the same time. He reminded Lita of something newly hatched, awkward, its down still damp and all askew. He smiled vaguely, opened the door wider, inviting her in even before she explained herself, as though he already knew.
Dylan sent me, she said,
then gazed with astonishment at the pillars and piles of books, scrolls, papers, everywhere, even in the rafters. The cauldron hanging over the cold grate was filthy. She could see a half-eaten loaf on a shelf in the open cupboard. A mouse was busily dealing with the other half. There were cobwebs everywhere and unwashed cups, odd implements she could not name tossed on the colorful, wrinkled puddles of clothes on the floor. As she stood gaping, an old wizened sausage, tumbled out of the rafters, fell at her feet. She jumped. The scholar picked up the sausage.
I was wondering what to have for breakfast.
He put it into his pocket.
You'd be Lita, then.
Yes, sir.
You can call me Ansley. My great-grandmother left me this cottage when she died. Did you know her?
Oh, yes. Everyone did.
I've been away in the city, studying. I decided to bring my studies here, where I can think without distractions. I want to be a great mage.
Oh?
It is an arduous endeavor, which is why I'll have no time for...
He gestured. She nodded.
I suppose when you've become a mage, all you'll have to do is snap your fingers or something.
His brows rose. Clearly, he had never considered the use of magic for housework.
Oh, something, he agreed doubtfully. You can see for yourself what I need you for.
Oh, yes.
He indicated the vast, beautifully carved table in a corner under a circular window from which the sunny river could be seen. Or could have been seen, but for the teetering pile of books blocking the view. Ansley must have brought the table with him. She wondered how he had gotten the massive thing through the door. Magic, maybe? It must be good for something.
You can clear up any clutter in the place but that, he told her. That must never be disturbed.
What about the moldy rind of cheese on top of the books?
He drew breath, held it.
No,
he said finally, decisively. Nothing on the table must be touched. I expect to be there most of the time anyway, learning spells and translating the ancient secrets in manuscripts.
When?
He asked a trifle anxiously.
Can you start?
She considered the various needs of her own husband and house, then yielded to his pleading eyes.
Now, she said, I suppose you want some food in the place.
He nodded eagerly, reaching for his purse.
All I ask, he told her, shaking coins into her hand, is not to be bothered. I'll pay whatever you ask for that. My father did well with the tavern he owned, and I even better when I sold it after he died. Just come and go and do whatever needs to be done. Can you manage that?
Of course, she said stolidly,
pocketing the coins for a trip to the market in the village at the edge of the woods.
I do it all the time.
She spent long days at the cottage, for the scholar paid scant attention to time, and often kept his nose in his books past sunset, despite the wonderful smells coming out of his pots. Dylan grumbled, but the scholar paid very well, and didn't mind Lita taking leave in the late afternoons to fix Dylan's supper and tend for an hour to her own house before she went back to work. She cooked, scrubbed, weeded, and washed, got a cat for the mice, and fed it too, swept and mended, and even wiped the grime off the windows, though the scholar never bothered looking out. Dylan worked hard as well, building cupboards and bedsteads for the villagers, chopping trees into cartloads of wood to sell in the market for winter. Some days she heard his axe from dawn to dusk. On market days, when he lingered in the village tavern, she rarely saw his face until one or the other of them crawled wearily into bed late at night.
"We never talk anymore,"
she murmured once, surprisedly, to the dark, when the warm, sweaty, grunting shape that was Dylan pushed under the bedclothes beside her.
"We just work and sleep, work and sleep."
He mumbled something that sounded like,
"What else is there?"
Then he rolled away from her and began to snore. One day, when Ansley had gone down to the river to hunt for the details of some spell, Lita made a few furtive passes with her broom at the dust under his work table. Her eye fell upon a spiral of gold on a page in an open book. She stopped sweeping, studied it. A golden letter, it looked like, surrounded by swirls of gold in a frame of crimson. All that richness, she marveled, for a letter. All that beauty. How could a simple letter, this undistinguished one that also began her name, be so cherished, given such loving attention?
"One little letter," she whispered,
and her thoughts strayed to earlier times, when Dylan gave her wildflowers and sweets from the market. She sighed. They were always so tired now, and she was growing thinner from so much work. They had more money, it was true, but she had no time to spend it, even on shoes, and Dylan never thought of bringing her home a ribbon or a bit of lace when he went to the village. And here was this letter, doing nothing more than being the first in a line of them, adorned in red and gold for no other reason than that it was itself. She touched her eyes, laughed ruefully at herself, thinking, "I'm jealous of a letter." Someone knocked at the door. She opened it, expecting Dylan, or a neighbor, or a tinker. Anyone except the man who stood there. She felt herself gaping, but could not stop. She could only think crazily of the letter again. How this man, too, must have come from some place where people, as well as words, carried such beauty about them. The young man wore a tunic of shimmering links of pure silver over black leather trousers and a pair of fine, supple boots. His cloak was deep blue-black, the color of his eyes. His crisp, dark curls shone like blackbirds' wings. He was young, but something, perhaps the long jeweled sword he wore, made both Dylan and Ansley seem much younger. His lean, grave face hinted of a world beyond the wood that not even the scholar had seen.
"I beg your pardon," he said gently, "for troubling you."
Lita closed her mouth.
"I'm looking for a certain palace of which I've heard rumors all my life. It is surrounded by a deadly ring of thorns, and many men have lost their lives attempting to break through that ensorcelled circle to rescue the sleeping princess within. Have you heard of it?"
"Aye,"
Lita said, and stuck there, slack-jawed again.
I...
Behind the man, his followers, rugged and plainly dressed, glanced at one another. That look, less courteous than the young man's, cleared Lita's head a bit.
"I haven't," she brought out finally. "But the man I work for is trying to be a mage. He knows a thousand things I don't."
"Then may I speak with him?"
He's out.
She gestured, saw the broom still in her hand, and hid it hastily behind her.
Down by the river, catching toads.
Toads?
For his magic.
She heard the faint snort. One of the followers pretended to be watching a crow fly. The other breathed,
My lord, perhaps we should ask farther down the road.
We'll ride to the river,
the young lord said, and turned to mount his horse again. He bowed graciously to Lita from his saddle.
Thank you. We are grateful.
Blinking at the light spangling off his harness and jewels, she watched him ride through the trees and toward the water. Then, slowly, she sat down, stunned and witless with wonder, until she heard Ansley's voice as he walked through the doorway and around her.
I found five,
he announced excitedly, putting a muddy bucket on his table.
One of them is pure white.
Did you see?
Her voice didn't come. She was sitting on the floor, she realized then, with the broom across her knees.
Did you see the... them?
Who?
He asked absently, picking toads out of the bucket and setting them on his papers.
The traveler. I sent him to talk to ye.
She hesitated, finally said the word.
I think he is a prince. He is looking for a palace surrounded by thorns, with a sleeping princess inside.
Oh, him. No, I mean, yes, but no, I couldn't help him. I had no idea what he was talking about. Come here and look at this white one. You can do so many things with the white toads.
She had to wait a long time before Dylan came home, but she stayed awake so that she could tell him. As he clambered into bed, breathing a gust of beer at her, she said breathlessly,
I saw a prince today, on his way to rescue a princess.
He laughed and hiccuped at the same time.
And I saw the queen of the fairies. Did you happen to spot my knife too? I set it down yesterday when I was whittling, and it must have strolled away.
Dylan?
He kissed her temple.
You're dreaming, love. No princes here.
The days lengthened. Hawthorn blossoms blew everywhere like snow, leaving green behind. The massive oaks covered their tangled boughs with leaves. An early summer storm thundered through the woods one afternoon. Lita, who had just spread Ansley's washing to dry on the hawthorn bushes around the cottage, heard the sudden snarl of wind, felt a cold, hard drop of rain on her mouth. She sighed. The clothes were wet anyway. But for the wild wind that might steal them, she could have left them out. She began to gather them back into her basket. She heard voices. They sounded like wind at first, one high, pure, one pitched low, rumbling. They didn't seem human, which made Lita duck warily behind a bush. But their words were human enough, which made her strain her ears to listen. It was, she thought bewilderedly, like hearing what the winds had to say for themselves.
Come into my arms and sleep, my lord,
the higher voice crooned.
You have lived a long and adventurous life. You may rest now for a while.
No,
the deeper voice protested, half laughing, half longing, Lita thought.
It's not time for me to sleep yet. There are things I still must teach you.
What things, my heart?
How to understand the language of beetles, how to spin with spindrift, what lies hidden in the deepest place in the ocean, and how to bring it up to light.
Sleep a little. Teach me when you wake again.
No, not yet.
Sleep.
Lita crept closer to the voices. The rain pattered down now, great fat drops the trees could not stop. Through the blur of rain and soughing winds stirring up the bracken, she saw two figures beneath an oak. They seemed completely unaware of the storm, as if they belonged to some enchanted world. The woman's long, fiery, rippling hair did not notice the wind, nor did the man's gray-white beard. He sat cradled in the oak roots, leaning back against the trunk. His face looked as harsh and weathered, as ancient and enduring as the wood. The woman stood over him, close enough for him to touch, which he did now and then, his hand caressing the back of her knee, coaxing it to bend. They were both richly dressed, he in a long silvery robe, flecked with tiny jewels like points of light along the sleeves, the hem. She wore silk, the deepest green of summer, the secret green of trees, who have taken in all the light they can hold, and feel somewhere within them, summer's end. His eyes were half closed. Hers were very wide as she stared down at him, pale amber encircling vivid points of black. Lita froze. She did not dare move, lest those terrible eyes lift from his and search her out behind the bush, with Ansley's trousers flapping on it.
"Sleep,"
the woman murmured again, her voice like a lightly dancing brook, like the sough of wind in reeds.
"Sleep."
His hand dropped from her knee. He made an effort, half lifting his eyelids. His eyes were silver, metallic like a knife blade.
"Not yet, my sweet Nemu. Not yet."
"Sleep."
He closed his eyes. There was a crack, as though the world had been torn apart. Then came the thunder. Lita screamed as she felt it roll over her, through her, and down beneath her into the earth. The ancient oak, split through its heart, trailing limbs like shattered bone, loosed sudden, dancing streams of fire. Rain fell then, in vast sheets as silvery as the sleeper's eyes. Lita couldn't see anything. She was drenched in a moment and sinking rapidly into a puddle. Rising, she glimpsed the light, shining from the cottage windows. She stumbled out of the mysterious world toward it. Wind blew her back through the scholar's door, then slammed the door behind her.
I saw,
she panted. But she did not know what she saw. Ansley, his attention caught at last by something outside his books, the thunder, maybe, or the lake she was making on his floor, looked a little pale in the gloom.
"You saw what?"
But she had only pieces to give him, nothing whole, nothing coherent.
"I saw his eyes close, and then lightning struck the oak."
Ansley moved then.
"Oh, I hope it won't topple onto my roof."
"His eyes closed. They were like metal. She put him to sleep with her eyes."
"Show me the tree."
She led him eagerly through the rain. It had slowed a little. The storm was moving on. Somewhere else in the wood, strange things were happening. The magic here had come and gone. They stood looking at the broken heart of the oak, its wood still smoldering, its snapped boughs sagging, shifting dangerously in the wind. Only a stand of gnarled trunk was left, where the sleeper had been sitting.
"Come away," Ansley said uneasily. "Those limbs may still fall."
"But I saw two people."
"They had sense enough to run, it seems. There are no bodies here. Just," he added, "a lot of wet clothes among the bushes. What exactly were those two doing?"
"They're your clothes."
"Oh."
She lingered, trying to find some shred of mystery left in the rain, some magic smoldering with the wood.
"He closed his eyes," she whispered, "and lightning struck the oak."
"Well, he must have opened them fast enough then," Ansley said. "Come back into the house. Leave the laundry. You can finish all that later."
His voice brightened as he wandered back through the dripping trees.
"This will send the toads out to sun."
She did not even try to tell Dylan. For if the young scholar, with all his books, saw no magic, how could he? Days passed, one very like the next. She cooked, washed, weeded in the garden. Flowers she had rescued from wild vines bloomed and faded. She picked herbs and beans and summer squashes. The scholar studied. One day the house was full of bats, the next full of crows. Another day he made everything disappear, including himself. Lita stepped, startled, into an empty cottage, not a thing in it, not even a stray spider. Then she saw the scholar's sheepish smile forming in the air. The rest of his possessions followed slowly. She stared at him, speechless. He cleared his throat.
I must have mistranslated a word or two in that spell.
You might have translated some of the clutter out of the door while you were at it,
she said. What had reappeared was as chaotic as ever. She could not imagine what he did at nights while she was at home. Invented whirlwinds or made his pots and clothes dance in midair until they dropped, it looked like.
Think of magic as an untamed creature,
he suggested, opening a book while he rained crumbs on the floor, chewing a crust he had found on his table.
I am learning ways to impose my will upon it, while it fights me with all its cunning for its freedom.
It sounds like your garden, she murmured, tracking down her gardening basket, which was not on the peg where she hung it, but, for some reason, on a shelf, in the frying pan.
The scholar made an absent noise, not really hearing her. She had gotten used to that. She went outside to pull up onions for soup. She listened for Dylan's axe while she dug. He had said he was cutting wood that day. But she didn't hear it. Just the river and the birds and the breeze among the leaves. He must have gone deeper than usual into the woods, she thought. But she felt the little frown between her brows growing tighter and tighter at his silence. For no reason, her throat grew tight too, hurt her suddenly. Maybe she had misunderstood. Maybe he had gone into the village to sell wood instead. That made the ache in her throat sharper. His eyes and voice were absent those days. He looked at her, but hardly saw her. He kissed her now and then, brief, chuckling kisses that you'd give to a child. But he had never gone to the village so often without her before. He had never wanted to go without her before. She asked him tentatively that night, as he rolled into bed in a cloud of beer fumes and wood smoke.
Will you take me with you next time?
He patted her shoulder, his eyes already closed.
You need your rest, working so hard for two houses. Anyway, it's nothing. I just have a quick drink and I listen to the fiddling. Then I'm home to you.
But it's so late.
He gave her another pat.
Is it? Then best get to sleep.
He snored. She stared, wide-eyed, back at the night. She scarcely noticed when the leaves first began to turn. Suddenly there were mushrooms and berries and nuts together, and apples all over the little twisty apple tree in her own garden. The days were growing shorter, even while there seemed so much more to do. She pulled out winter garments to mend where the moths had chewed. She replenished supplies of soap and candles. Her hands were always red. Her hair, it seemed, always slightly damp with steam from something. The leaves grew gold, began to fall, crackle underfoot, as she walked from one house to the other and back again. She scarcely saw the two men, the scholar hunched over a book with his back to her, her husband always calling goodbye as he went to chop or sell or build. Well, they scarcely saw her either, she thought tiredly. That was the way of it. She stayed into the evening at the scholar's one day, darning his winter cloak while the stew she had made of carrots and potatoes and leeks bubbled over the fire. He was at his table, staring into what looked like a glass bowl filled with swirling iridescent fires. he was murmuring to it. If it answered him, she didn't hear. At least, not for some time. When she began to hear the strange, crazed disturbance beneath the wind rattling at the door, she thought at first that the sound came from within the globe. Her needle paused. The noise seemed to be coming closer, a disturbing confusion of dogs barking, horns, faint bells, shouting, bracken and fallen limbs crackling under the pounding of many hooves. She stared at the glass ball, which was hardly bigger than the scholar's fist. Surely such an uproar couldn't be coming from that. The wind shrieked suddenly. The door shook on its hinges. She froze mid-stitch. The door sprang open as if somebody had kicked it. All the confusion in the night seemed to be on the scholar's doorstep and about to roil into his cottage. She leaped to her feet, terrified, and clung to the door, trying to force it shut against the wind. A dark current was passing the house, something huge and nameless, bewildering, until her eyes began to find the shapes in the night. They appeared at random, lit by fires that seemed to stream from the nostrils of black horses galloping past her. The flames illumined great hounds with eyes like coals, upraised sword blades like broken pieces of lightning, cowled faces, harnesses strung with madly clamoring bells. She stared, unable to move. One of the hooded faces turned toward her as his enormous horse, its hooves sparking fire, cleared her potato rows. The rider's face was gaunt, bony, his hair in many long braids, their ends secured around clattering bones. He wore a crown of gold. Its great jewel reflected fire the color of a splash of blood. White moons in the rider's eye sockets flashed at Lita. He opened his jaws wide, like a wolf, and laughed. She could not even scream. Her voice was that shriveled with fear. She could only squeak. Then the door was taken firmly out of her hands, closed against the night. The scholar grumbled, returning to his work.
I couldn't hear a thing with all that racket. Are you still here? Take a lamp with you when you go home.
She went home late, terrified at every step, every whine of wind and crackle of branch. Her cold hands woke Dylan as she hugged him close in their bed for warmth and comfort. He raised his head, breathing something that may have been a name, and maybe not. Then his voice came clear.
You're late.
He did not sound worried or angry, only sleepy.
Your hands are ice.
Dylan, there was something wicked in the woods tonight.
What?
I don't know. Riders, dark riders on horses with flaming breath. I heard horns, as if they were hunting.
Nobody hunts in the dark.
Didn't you hear it?
No.
Were you even here?
She asked incredulously. He turned away from her, settled himself again.
Of course, you weren't though, so I went to bed.
You could have come to fetch me,
she whispered.
You could have brought a lamp.
What?
You could have wondered.
Go to sleep,
he murmured.
Sleep.
Winter, she thought, as she walked to the scholar's cottage the next morning. There wouldn't be so much work then, with the snow flying. No gardens to tend, no trees to chop, with their wood damp and iron-clad. She and Dylan would see more of one another, then. She'd settle the scholar and come home before dark. They'd have long evenings together beside the fire. Leaves whirled around her. The brightly colored autumn squashes were almost the last things still unpicked in the garden, besides the root vegetables. One breath of frost, and the herbs would be gone, along with most of the green in the world.
You'll need wood for winter, she reminded the scholar. I'll have Dylan bring you some.
He grunted absently. She sighed a little, watching him as she tied on her apron. I've grown invisible, she thought. Later, she caught herself longing for winter and didn't know whether to laugh or cry. Dylan stacked the scholar's wood under the eaves. The squashes grew fat as the garden withered around them. The air smelled of rain and sweet wood smoke. Now and then the sky turned blue. Fish jumped into sunlight. The world cast a glance back at the season it had left. On one of those rare days, Lita spread the washing on the bushes to dry. Drawn to the shattered oak, she left her basket and walked through the brush to look at it, search for some sign that she had truly seen whatever she had seen. The great gnarled stump, so thick that two or maybe three of her might have ringed it with her arms, stood just taller than her head. Only this lower, rooted piece of trunk was left intact, though lightning had seared a black stain on it like a scar. It stood dreaming in the sunlight, revealing nothing of its secrets. Just big enough, she thought, to draw a man inside it, if one had fallen asleep against it. In spring, living shoots would rise like his dreams out of the trunk, crown it with leaves, this still living heart big enough to hide a sleeping mage. Something moving down the river caught her eyes. She went through the trees toward it, unable to see clearly what it was. An empty boat, it seemed, caught in the current. But that didn't explain its odd shape, and the hints of color about it, the drift of cloth that was not sail. She ran down the river path a ways to get ahead of it, so that she could see it clearly as it passed. It seemed a fine, delicate.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.